One of the most common questions you'll have when trying to tune SQL queries is, why the is the database not using my index? As far as you're concerned, there's a perfectly good index available. The query returns few rows, all the columns in the index are in your where clause, and there's no functions on them. But the database is decided to go with a full table scan instead. Why? In this episode, we'll investigate one of the most important but also most overlooked factors behind this decision, the clustering factor. Let's start with a quick recap of how the database finds rows using an index or a full table scan. With a full table scan, the database will pick up all the blocks in the table, finding rows matching your search criteria, keeping those that do, and discarding those that don't. With an index range scan, on the other hand, the database first goes to the index to find entries matching your search. It will then only access those blocks containing rows matching your search criteria. How many blocks the database accesses when using an index depends on where those rows are physically located in the table. For example, I've got my table here with 5 blocks in it. And when I'm doing a full table scan, I'm always going to read and pick up all 5 of these blocks. But when using an index, there are 2 possible extremes. All the rows I want might be located in just 1 block, so I can get everything in 1 IO. Or there might be 1 row I want from each block, meaning I need to pick each of the blocks up once to get the information, going to 5 IOs. The same amount of work as the full table scan. So the amount of work we do with an index varies depending on where those rows are physically located. What happens now if I've got a query that is finding 10 rows from the table? Well, again, there's 2 possible extremes. Everything I might want might be located in just 1 block, so I can get all 10 rows with 1 IO. Or there might be 2 rows I want from each block, and I might have to go through the table once, picking up each block and getting just 1 row from each. Then I have to go through the table again to get the 2nd row from each block. So here, to get the 10 rows, the amount of work I do varies from less than half the work of a full table scan to more than double. So how does the database know how many blocks it's going to access using the index before running the query? Well, the short answer is, it doesn't. So it estimates via the clustering factor. So what is this clustering factor and how does it help? The clustering factor is a counter that the database calculates when gathering statistics on a table. For each index, it walks down the entries, and for each entry asks, is this in the same block as the previous entry? If the answer is no, it increments the counter. If it's the same, then it leaves it untouched. So we end up with a value which has a lower bound of the number of blocks in the table and an upper bound of the number of rows in a table. So the higher the clustering factor is, the more scattered throughout the table the rows are relative to the order in the index, and the less effective the index is likely to be. Now, at this point, you may be a bit skeptical and say, does it really make that much difference? Let's run a quick demo to find out. I have a table here which stores 10,000 rows, and these are stored in just over 100 blocks. There are currently 3 indexes on this table, on the primary key column, and this index is perfectly clustered because we can see its value is less than the number of blocks. An index on the weight column, which is almost perfectly unclustered because its clustering factor is close to the number of rows, and an index on the insert date column, which is somewhere between the two. The weight values are evenly spread between 1 and 1000. I'm going to search for weights between 1 and 100, so this should return about 10% of the rows from the table. If we look at the execution plan, we find that the database does a full table scan to access this, which is what we would expect because that weight index is very poorly clustered, and we get 1,000 rows just over, so about 10% of the table, and it took 130 buffer gets to do this. Let's see what happens if we now force the database to use the index. We get the execution plan, and we can see that the database does indeed use the index, returns the same number of rows, but now the number of gets, the amount of work or I/O it does, has jumped considerably to nearly 1,000. As is just over 100 blocks in the table, we must have accessed each one nearly 10 times. So the database was right to use the full table scan in this scenario. A quick note, I used an index hint in the previous query. This sounds like I'm giving the optimizer a suggestion. Optimizer, if you wouldn't mind, would you perhaps consider maybe using this index? I'm not. I'm giving the optimizer a directive, an order. Optimizer, you must use this index, if it's possible to do so. This is useful for demos and training purposes, but in real production SQL, it can mean that the optimizer is unable to find the best plan, particularly as your data changes. So you should avoid using hints in your production code. I repeat, avoid hints in your application code. Returning to the demo, I'm now going to search the bricks table for primary key values between 1 and 1,000. Again, about 10% of the rows in the table. The index on this column is perfectly clustered, so we hope that the database will use the index. And when we look at the execution plan, we find that indeed this is what it does. It gets 1,000 rows in just over 30 gets, roughly a quarter of the work of the full table scan. So this is the correct choice. In fact, we can get as many as 20% of the rows from the table using this perfectly clustered primary key index. And when we look at the execution plan, we get 20% of the rows in just under 70 gets, roughly half the work of the full table scan. So how effective an index is really depends on where those rows are physically stored in the table relative to their position in the index. The more closely aligned they are, the more effective that index will be. So, as the clustering factor increases, the less effective the index is likely to be, and the more likely the database is to use a full table scan. This is obvious at the extremes, but what about our partially clustered indexes, such as the insert date? This is particularly interesting because the values for it will always increase. So new entries are going to go on the right-hand edge of the index. And as we add new rows to the table, assuming it's a standard heap table, they will typically go at the end of the table. But they're not always going to go in exactly the last block. They're likely to be spread over the last couple of blocks. So if we're searching for recent rows, all the information is going to be located in just a couple of locations. So will the database use this index or not? This query searches the bricks table for rows inserted in February. Looking at the execution plan, we can find that it returns 600 odd rows, about 6 to 7% of the total in the table, and it does this using a full table scan. If we now see what happens when we force the database to use an index, we see that it fetches the same number of rows, but it does so using 70 gets, about half the work of the full table scan. So the database got it wrong here. Why is this and what can we do about it? The problem is the clustering factor is pessimistic. Luckily, Oracle Database 12c added a workaround. This included the preference table cached blocks. This changes how the clustering factor calculation works. Instead of asking, is the current block for the current index entry the same as the previous index entry, it asks, has the current block appeared in the past n table cached blocks index entries? So the counter only increases if we haven't seen the current block recently. This defaults to 1. So what happens if we increase it? If we look at the table cached blocks preference for the bricks table, we find it's currently at the default of 1. If we increase this up to 16 and regather stats on the table, when we look at the clustering factor for this index, we see it is now dropped down to the same value as the primary key index. When we now rerun our query searching for bricks added in February, we find that the database chooses the index as we hoped it would. One of the first things we're taught when learning how to tune SQL queries is the database should use an index if the query returns few rows. But I contend this is bad advice. Okay, sure, if you know your query is going to return one or two rows at most, then yes, you basically always want to use an index. But what if you're going to get 10 rows from the table, 100, 1,000? Knowing this doesn't help you understand whether an index will be effective or not. What you need to look at instead is how many blocks from the table will your query access using that index, and how does that compare to the total number of blocks in the table. Provided the index enables you to read fewer blocks from the table than there are in total, then it's the right way to go. As soon as that index means you have to reread many blocks, then a full table scan is the right method. Sadly, there is no way to know this for sure other than to run the query and find out. The clustering factor does give an indication of how likely the index is to be effective, with higher values meaning it's going to be less effective, but by default, this is pessimistic. So setting the table cached blocks to a small value, such as 10, enables the database to come up with better estimates for mostly clustered data, allowing you to get good performance from your SQL statements without having to rely on clumsy hacks such as hints. Thanks for watching. Still got questions about indexes? Ask us in the comments. And subscribe for more SQL tips.